بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما أما بعد. Tonight's halaqa is about the diseases of the heart. We'll mention a few inshallah and we'll mention the remedy for how to get rid of these diseases and purify our hearts and perform the tazkiyah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to perform. And tazkiyah is numu and barakah and ziyadah fil khayr. When we say one is performing tazkiyah, means that one is growing themselves, is purifying their hearts. They are seeking the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they are increasing their acts of righteousness in order for this tazkiyah to take place. First and foremost, we mentioned that the tazkiyah takes place in the hearts that are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that they are constantly vigilant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they love and they stay close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of staying close to the Quran, which is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and following the sunnah of his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Aside from that, tazkiyah will be, you know, a recipe for failure, if you will, or the plan of action will be a recipe, you know, for failure. We mentioned some of the greatest diseases that inflict the heart that wal'iyadu billah could either circumvent one from following the guidance or could cause one to exit the state of Islam to a state of apostasy or could cause some detrimental damage that is irreparable. So one of these diseases is called al-kibr. Al-kibr means, roughly translated into English, to mean arrogance. And al-kibr by definition is batru al-haqqi wa ghamdu al-nas. Batr al-haq means the refusal to accept or follow the truth because of the source. And we have a very fine example in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about those who refuse to accept the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because they perceive guidance that is valid to come only at the hands of those who have a status in the society, those who have wealth, those who have children. And they say, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَىٰ رَجُلَيْنِ مِنَ الْقَرْيَةِ عَظِيمٍ عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَةَانِ عَظِيمٍ. And they said that if this Qur'an was revealed upon a man, عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَةَانِ, either a Ta'if or Quraysh, عَظِيمٍ, that they perceived that this is the source of guidance and these are the two towns that would have been ideal for a man to be sent, a man of status, a man of wealth, a man of, you know, high ranks in the society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly answers him in the Quran with his infinite knowledge and wisdom, and he says, أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ. Are they the ones who are going to divide the share of, or the shares of mercy, of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then he adds, subhanahu wa ta'ala, نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. We are the ones with our infinite knowledge and wisdom. We are the ones with the dominance over the dominion of the heavens and the earth. We have divided their sustenance. نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. In this dunya, we are the ones who divide the bounties and the shares of mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees among his slaves. So this is one act of arrogance that the disbelievers have adopted as a principle. And they said, we are not going to accept the truth because of the source. And this is the very definition of, you know, the concept or the term kibr, which is arrogance, refusal to accept the truth because of the source that it came from, because of the man that it came from. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the other hand, addresses the believers and he says, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنًا, that the true believers, those who are men and women of faculty and intellect, those are the ones, يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ, they listen attentively to the words of wisdom. And notice that here, the speaker is not mentioned. The one who's saying these words of wisdom is not mentioned because that's irrelevant. Because what's relevant, and the point is to accept the words of wisdom irrespective of the source. الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَ Those who listen to the words of wisdom and the advice and the guidance and they follow the best of it. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهُ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ أُولَى الْأَلْبَابِ Those are the ones who are truly guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those are truly are people of, you know, healthy intellect, healthy mindset. So we can see throughout the history of mankind and even before that, even before Adam alayhi salam came alive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the unknowing, knew that Iblis la'anahullah, Satan, had built up such level of arrogance, was conceited in his ibadah, because he has worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala almost in every place. He has made sujood in every spot on the face of the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him such a high status among the angels. So arrogance began to build in him. And he began to recognize less and less that the source of this guidance and the source of this honor is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the all-knowing, wanted to test him. So when he created Adam, and he created him with his own hands, and he blew a decree, a soul that be blown into him, as a special decree, kalima, directly to Adam alayhi salam, and he has taught him the names of everything, and he has made the angels prostrate themselves as an act of honor to Adam alayhi salam, then he commanded Iblis, la'anahullah, may the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon him, to prostrate himself to Adam. He said, I will not. I'm better than him. You have created me from fire and you've created him from mud. But the issue is not really the substance of the creation of either Adam or Iblis. The issue is the fact that Iblis, la'anahullah, refused to continue to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which falls under the form of tawheed of al-uluhiyya. Tawheed al-uluhiyya, who we take as a deity that is rightfully worshipped. Who do we take as a God that we submit and obey at all times without any preconditions, without any objections whatsoever? That's why the scholars characterize this type of tawheed or this type of belief that is a keen belief, deep convictions that do not accept any defiance whatsoever. Not even the smallest percentage at all. So Iblis la'anahullah refused in spite of his knowledge, and in spite of his ibadah, and in spite of the status that he had, he simply refused to obey because he was jealous of Adam alayhi salam. He was jealous of Adam alayhi salam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that none enters paradise, even with the weight of an Adam of kibr, arrogance inside their hearts. Because the best of ibadah that we can render to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is rendered with utmost love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and utmost humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because as he characterizes us in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal nas, antumul fuqara, we are the ones who are poor. And we are the ones who are needy in every possible aspect of the world. We are needy when it comes to being able to function as a body, as a coherent body, as a mind, being able to eat, being able to be guided, being able to breathe, being able to walk, to make any movement whatsoever. We are in desperate need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as-samad, the one who sustains his creation. Without him, we would cease to exist. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the all-wealthy, the self-subsisting, and the sufficient, that is not in need of anyone of his creation. So this is the first disease of the heart that we, it doesn't matter how much guidance Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. It doesn't matter how much wealth Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. It doesn't matter how many children Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. It doesn't matter how much knowledge we become aware of. We must recognize first and foremost the source of all of these bounties is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And without him we'd be cut off. We'd be cut off. We'll have nothing, absolutely nothing. And without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we'll even cease to exist. So therefore, what we have learned in the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيَّ وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي If we remember these two aspects of the dua, I confess to you with your bounty over me. Whatever source of goodness is from you. وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي And I confess my sin, that I'm sinful, that I'm a person who makes mistake, that I'm deficient in every aspect of the world. If we remember to keep these two words in mind, that will help us maintain our humility towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that will help us maintain our humbleness towards others, the creation, the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second disease that we talk about, and of course we're talking about these diseases in a very brief, you know, summary, if you will, just to narrate them and then to come up, you know, with the recipe or the way to treat such diseases, because it's incumbent upon us as part of the tazkiyah, and it's a rule in the fiqh of the sharia, at-takhalli qabla at-tahalli, that before you try to acquire good qualities and good traits as a Muslim, that you ought to rid yourself of the diseases of the heart first and foremost, because these are the ones that are utmost danger, because these are the ones that infect the heart where iman rests. Al-Iman ma waqara fi al-qalb wa nataqa bihi al-lisan wa saddaqahu al-amal. Iman is what's rooted in the heart. Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love of His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in the heart. So if the heart is ailing, if the heart is ill, then we're going to have difficulties achieving that level of love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects of us, as He says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. We cannot be more intense of our love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and more intense of our love to His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our hearts, and our hearts are ailing. Our hearts are sick, وَالْعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. That's the place of love. That's the place of the intention. Our intention would be compromised. Our sincerity in rendering the deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be compromised. Why? Because that's the place, that is the heart. And the heart is ailing, the heart is not healthy. So therefore, the rest will follow suit. And wa'iyadu billah, depending on the level of illness of the heart, that could render one to exit the state of Islam to a state of apostasy. And on Judgment Day, none of their deeds will be accepted. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. And we have come to all the deeds that they performed that were corrupted, because their hearts were corrupted, and we made it like haba'an manthura, is these little particles that you see when a beam of light comes through the window or through a glass, and then you see these little particles that you can only see through that beam of light. They have absolutely no weight. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we make their deeds have no weight, just like these little particles in the, you know, that are seen only through the beam of light, have absolutely no weight. The second disease that we talk about, which is a very, very dangerous one, which is also an objection to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and showing dissatisfaction to the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided sustenance among His slaves, which is jealousy. Jealousy is of two different levels. And jealousy is an ill feeling that mingles with it dislike and hate of khayr, that which is good for others. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us in the hadith, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. That none of you is a true believer until they love that which they love for themselves, they love it for their brothers, and they love it for their sisters as well. So for one to be infected with riyad al-Allah, one's heart to be infected with this type of disease, which is jealousy, meaning that at the first level, which is the worst level, is that they wish for this ni'mah, this bounty, whatever it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon this person, to go away. This is it, that's the mission, that's immediate goal, that's the immediate goal. And we've seen that, which was an objection by some groups of the Israelites at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the ayah that we mentioned, they wanted that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come from one of these two great towns. And in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّونَكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ كُفَّارًا حَسَدًا مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. That many of the people of the book would wish that you would convert or revert back into a state of apostasy, state of disbelief, right? مِنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ, after you are believers. مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الْحَقِّ, after the truth has become so evident to them. After the descriptions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, that were mentioned in the Torah and the Old Testament, were clearly fitting the personality and the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they verified that and they confirmed that. They wish for you to go back into a state of apostasy after you became believers. Why? The only reason, hasadan min indi anfusim, out of envy, you know, of the hearts, out of envy from themselves. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَعْفُوا وَصْفَحُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِ. You know, just forgive and leave that alone until the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a clear threat for them. يَأْتِيَ بِأَمْرِ, until that decree comes, you know, for you to see it, you know, with your own eyes. The second level of hasad, The second level of hasad is of lesser caliber, which is one sees something that they like, that their brother or their sister have, and they wish for something like it. Here we're talking about matters that are worldly matters, that are going to perish. Okay? And this is, of course, of a lesser degree. But there is a type of hasad that is not bad. And in fact, the Prophet ﷺ confirms that in the hadith when he says, لا حسد إلا فتنتين. There is no hasad, jealousy, except in two matters. And here the Prophet ﷺ is talking about these two matters that are compliant with the Sharia. So these are good things. And what are these good things? رجل آتاه الله القرآن. A man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the Qur'an to, in terms of understanding, memorization, and application. فَهُوَ يَقُومُ بِهِ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ. So he or she is doing قِيَامِ اللَّيْلِ at night, reciting the Qur'an, and they are applying it during the day. And the other person is a person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala آتَاهُ مَالًا. He has given him wealth, material wealth. فَسَلَّطَهُ عَلَى هَلَكَتِهِ فِي الْحَقِّ. So this person used this wealth in order to establish al-haq, to establish the truth. In other words, to sponsor the orphans, to help the widows, to spend fi sabilillah, to spend in every aspect that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased for this wealth to be spent of. In this case, if one wishes to have something like that so they can spend it fi sabilillah, there is no harm in that. Why is that? The wisdom behind that is that this person is seeking the hereafter. In other words, this person is seeking doing good deeds. This person is seeking the tazkiyah of the heart. This person is seeking the tazkiyah of the limbs. Because a person who is reciting the Quran at night and doing qiyam al-layl and applying during the day with its utmost guidance, this person is seeking the hereafter. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفِي ذَلِكَ فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ. We are invited to compete in these areas. We are invited to compete for the hereafter. We are invited to compete for Jannah, عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ, a paradise the width of which is the heavens and the earth. And similarly, the other person is a man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given wealth. And this person, and for example, like Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, he was such an extremely wealthy man. But he has spent all of his wealth, or the majority of his wealth, fi sabilillah. He spent it for sadaqah. He spent it in tazkiyah. He spent it for the preparation of militaries that have went to give da'wah fi sabilillah and to wage jihad fi sabilillah. He spent it on the companions. He spent it on the poor and the orphan and the widows. So we can see that this is a person is seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a person that is sacrificing that which they love for the sake of the greater love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, we see Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu has given all of his wealth. All of his wealth fi sabilillah. We see that Umar has given half of his wealth fi sabilillah. So those poor, when they look at this, they say, we have nothing to give. A person like Abi Dandan, another Sahabi, who had no wealth to give and wanted to give sadaqah fi sabilillah, he said, oh Allah, I have no money to give fi sabilillah. So whoever spoke ill about me, whoever defamed my character, whoever committed ghibah, you know, I spoke behind my back in vain talk, whoever committed namima or accused me of anything that is untrue, it's a sadaqah, it's an act of charity from me over him. So you can see how keen the sahaba who had the money and didn't have the money in giving sadaqah fi sabilillah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives his divine testament to Abu Bakr and others, as he says, وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. That Abu Bakr has given everything that he has given fi sabilillah, only seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hoping for his rewards and fearing his punishment. وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى. That he was not seeking any other gains, status, people to say that he's generous, people to say that he spends, you know, left and right. He was not seeking reputation. He was not seeking status. He was not seeking a return, you know, for that investment. Just like those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of when he says, وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِن رِبًا لِيَرْبُوَ فِي أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ فَلَا يَرْبُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. The riba here that is mentioned in Surah Al-Rum in this ayah is when one gives a gift to a wealthy person, hoping what? That this wealthy person will return this gift with a greater gift. Because everyone gives according to their affordability, according to their capacity. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِن رِبًا لِيَرْبُوَ فِي أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ فَلَا يَرْبُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ This type of gift is not going to be nurtured and grown in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِّن زَكَاةٍ تُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُضْعِفُونَ As for that which you give fi sabilillah, be it zakat al-mal, or beyond that, sadaqah, in order for what? تُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُضْعِفُونَ Those are the ones who are going to receive multiple, you know, rewards and returns for their investment. To the extent, in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, even if one spends half a date, that small date that we break our fast on, if one's to spend half a date, fi sabilillah, and that's all they have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept it with his right hand. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will continue to grow this half date for this individual until this individual meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the return is the size of a great mountain. The return on this half date is the size of a great mountain. So la hasada illa fi ithnatayn, there is no envy except in these two matters, one who's been given the Quran and one who's been given, you know, wealth to spend it fi sabila. So if someone has been given the Quran and they're not really reciting it at night, they're not doing qiyam illah, they're not applying during the day, there's no envy here. Because these are deeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes. And these are deeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes for. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him this tremendous bounty, and this person is not using this bounty to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, one who's been given wealth and they're spending it, not only they don't spend it fi sabilillah, but they spend it as an act of disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To fight Islam and the Muslims, to spend it on corruption, to spread corruption in the land. You know, all of that, there is no envy here. This is a person. يعني إن هؤلاء متبر ما كان اللهم فيه that people who do this they are gaining سيئات just like قارون لعنه الله إنما أوتيته على علم عندي I was given this because of knowledge that I possessed and he spends it for that which displeases Allah سبحانه وتعالى so this one comes to you know the second disease which is jealousy the third disease is a disease maybe you haven't heard about or we don't hear about you often At-taqleed, blind copying of others. What does blind copying of others do? Here, with the youngsters, they call it peer pressure. What is peer pressure? Is that a youngster would see somebody else, perhaps it's a group, and they're doing something wrong, and be it smoking cigarettes, drinking alcohol, doing drugs, whatever the case might be, and because of this peer pressure, he or she begins to emulate. They're not really convinced. They're not convinced of this. They know it's harmful for them. But the way it's presented to them, you know, by shaitan, that it's a form of zina, it's beautified. It's made to look good. And add to that the pressure of their peers, they begin to follow and emulate. Sometimes this could happen also in matters of our deen. People who do not take the time, you know, to learn their deen, to learn the Quran, to learn the sunnah, to learn the sharia, oftentimes you'll find them emulating. They look at one person in the musalla, they look at a Muslim that they may like or that, and they begin to emulate. He must be doing the right thing. Or they look at the group sometimes, which is even worse. You know, when the group performs a deed, it doesn't make it right because of their numbers. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ That the vast majority of people, or Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if you do your very best to try to guide them, they shall not become believers. So if we follow the vast majority, we're upon misguidance. And even among the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يُؤْمِنُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ وَلِعَذَا بِاللَّهِ Even those who claim to be Muslims, they claim to be believers, the majority of which they do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except in a state of shirk. And that it be shirk in al-rububiyyah. You know, associating partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the creation of everything in existence. أو شرك في الألوهية associating partners in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to disposing of our ibadah in part or in whole. Or شرك in الأسماء والصفات associating partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misinterpreting his names. Or creating other entities that resemble Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be it in himself or in his names, divine names or divine attributes or in his actions. So the fourth one is also the issue of, you know, the submittance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the one and the only one authority, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the fine example that we've been commanded to follow and to love and to emulate for those who wish to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on favorable terms, and they oftentimes remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in any of these four categories, that could be also a form of shirk, that wal-iyadu billah, those who claim to be Muslims are also committed. So this is, you know, the shu'm, you know, of emulation. So we as Muslims, we should not emulate anyone except the Prophet. We should not seek knowledge through, except through the Quran and the Sunnah. We should not ask for guidance except through the scholars and the students of knowledge and those who truly have the knowledge from the source. Emulation or blind copying is also mentioned in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَرْغَبُ عَنْ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِهَ نَفْسَهُ. That none truly deviates from the millah of Ibrahim, the millah of Tawheed, the millah of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, which is the source of all good. The source of all good is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So whoever deviates from the millah of Ibrahim alayhi salam, إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِهَ نَفْسَهُ. One who undermines his very own intellect. Why? Because they leave the guidance aside, and they follow their forefathers. إِنَّا وَجَدْنَا أَبَاءَنَا عَلَىٰ أُمَّةٍ وَإِنَّا عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ مُقْتَدُونَ. That we have found our forefathers doing this, therefore we are following. So that's the only reason, just blind copying, blind copying. The fourth disease of the heart is stubbornness. Stubbornness in what sense? Meaning that there are people, you try to share the truth with them, huh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا. You try to share the dhikr, the Qur'an, the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the guidance with them, and their default is to resist. Their default is to not accept. And everything is an argument. Even the matters that are just so clearly outlined in the Qur'an and the Sunnah, they argue against that. What is the proof? What is the evidence? Here's the proof. Here's the evidence. Just like somebody staring at the sun and saying, this is not the sun, and this is not the moon. You're just making things up. It's like, this is very clearly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created upon the fitrah, the predisposition to turn to none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to supplicate to none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they've taken this, you know, barrier of stubbornness to isolate themselves from the truth. And sometimes if you say, okay, take the time, investigate, use your own intellect, ponder, look, see, learn, they say, no. We don't want that. We fear that this is going to be magic or this and that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will address them on Judgment Day and say, أَكَفَرْتُمْ وَلَمْ تُحِيطُوا بِهِ عِلْمًا. You disbelieved without even taking the time to read and understand. That's why we recall that the first few words that were revealed in the Qur'an, اِقْرَأْ بِاسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقْ. Follow the fitrah. Shape that fitrah. Follow the fitrah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created upon, and read by the name Rabbika, the controller, the owner, the sustainer, the cherisher, الذي خلق, the one who created everything. Read in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, read for the purpose of finding the truth, not for the purpose of arguing and try to present a counter argument and counter evidence which does not even exist. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. Don't read for any other purpose, but for the purpose of finding the truth. أكفرتم ولم تحيطوا به علما أم ماذا كنتم تعملون. What were you doing? How were you spending your time in vain? What purpose was there for your creation? So on and so forth. I'll mention this fifth disease inshallah, and I'll conclude with that just in the interest of time. And then inshallah we'll go into the solution of how to rectify this heart, and how to bring it back to the state of fitrah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created upon, and how to grow this heart upon the truth and upon guidance and upon that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Last but not least, ghiba, namima, buhtan, vain talk, all of this is a waste of time. This is nothing but a waste of time, and this is not but burning one's own hasanat. Did you know that every ghiba you commit, and every namima you commit, and we said ghiba, speaking ill behind your brother's back, as the Prophet ﷺ says, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْغِيبَ. Do you know what ghiba is? قَالُوا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَعْلَمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet ﷺ know best. He said, الْغِيبَ أَن تَذْكُرَ أَخَاكَ فِي مَا يَكْرَهُ. that you mention the name of your brother and that which he dislikes or hates. قِيلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَرَأَيْتَ إِن كَانَ فِي أَخِي مَا أَقُولُ. Say, O Prophet of Allah, do you see if what I'm saying is true, that this trait exists in him? He said, إِن كَانَ فِيهِ مَا تَقُولُ فَهِيَ غِيبَةٌ. He said, it's ghiba even if it's true. And if it's not true, it's buhtan, which is even a level that's greater. It's buhtan. And if you transpire these words to others for the sake of disrupting relationships, that's called namima, which is even worse. Which is even worse. In other words, you're spreading vain talk, true or untrue, for the sake of disrupting relationships. And this, if this shows anything, it shows how ill this heart is. That this person could possibly need a heart transplant, not physically, but, you know, or an overhaul, if you will, of the heart. And the Prophet ﷺ tells us this is also a sign of extremely weak iman. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commissioned us to practice tazkiyah of our nafs, tazkiyah of our heart, tazkiyah of our deeds, tazkiyah of everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And he says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. That those who are successful are those who are engaging in the tazkiyah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects of us. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commissioned us with this tazkiyah, and you put it aside. You're not even paying attention to it. وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. And you follow your whims and desires and everything that the nafs, you know, whispers or commands you to do. Add to that, of course, the fact that these are, you know, bad deeds. In other words, you're not busy doing the good deeds that are going to elevate you in ranks, that are going to wipe out the bad deeds. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, used to say, a good deed has so many benefits. So it's not just about hasanat. He said, in a good deed, there is nur in the qalb. There's nur in one's heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says so in Surah Al-Hadid, where he says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَآمِنُوا بِرَسُولِهِ يُوتِكُمْ كِفْلَيْنِ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ نُورًا تَمْشُونَ بِهِ. Or you who believe, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَآمِنُوا بِرَسُولِهِ, means that follow his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يُوتِكُمْ كِفْلَيْنِ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ, he will unfold his mercy over you more than the share that is written for you. More than that. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ نُورًا تَمْشُونَ بِهِ, and he will give you a guiding light that you'll be able to see the truth from falsehood. You'll be able to remove the shubahat, any infections of the aqeedah, wal-iyadu billah, or any deficiencies in one's aqeedah, and to purify that part which is in the head. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ نُورًا تَمْشُونَ بِهِ, and he will also purify your deeds, and will give you more of the hasanat, and more of the guidance to even enrich yourself with more deeds. So Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, he's among the tabi'een, he used to say that a good deed has or creates nur in the heart. Diya fil wajh. That your face, people look at it and say, mashallah, there's like light in this person's face. Quwwa fil badan. Strength in the body. Expansion, si'a fil rizq. Expansion in the rizq. Imagine all these good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ آمَنَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ. Huh? أَبْوَابًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. So if the people of the book were to believe and to affirm their declaration of the faith with good deeds, we would have opened the gates of sustenance for them from the heavens. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the tongue of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ أَسَرَّهُ, whoever is pleased, أَنْ يُنْسَأَ لَهُ فِي عُمْرِ. Huh? That his life is extended. His life is good. And his sustenance to be expanded, فَلْيَصَرْ رَحْمَةً, to enjoin blood relationships, to practice birr towards your parents, to enjoin blood relationships, to kindle your relationships with your relatives. This is a source of expanding one's life and giving you more health and giving you more sustenance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can begin to see the understanding of the scholars and the companions of the tabi'een when they spent fi sabilillah and when they've done, you know, their good deeds, that they are looking for a length, you know, and a health, and they're looking for sustenance, and they're looking for all these good things. So, just to wrap this up, and mention, or reiterate, and expand upon what we mentioned at the beginning of this halaqa, that this heart can never be rectified, can never be purified, which is the leader of rest of the body, as the Prophet ﷺ says, أَلَا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً. In the body there is a mudgha. إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ بَاقِ الْجَسَدِ. So the heart is the leader. If the heart is good, which is the place of the intention, the place of the sincerity, the place of the iman, and then enriched by the soul, which is the place of the ihsan, the perfection of the deeds. That comes through the soul, which is mysterious to us, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us we are made up of three components: the mind, the body, and the soul. Iman addresses the mind. Ibadat address the limbs. We perform the ibadat with our limbs, with our bodies. And ihsan addresses the soul of the human being. So to purify the leader of this being at large, this human being at large, it starts with the purification of the heart, ridding these hearts from all sorts of illnesses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His infinite guidance and mercy, He says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. In this Qur'an we descend upon you, مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ. In it where there is cure from every disease, beginning with the diseases of the heart, beginning with ridding ourselves from the whims and desires that are unlawful, or channeling these whims and desires into that which is lawful, showing us the true path to guidance. As-sirat al-mustaqim, as we supplicate in every rak'ah, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. This is what the Qur'an guides to. In hadha al-Qur'ana yahdi lillati hiya aqwam. This Qur'an guides to the best of the best. In other words, it cannot be, you know, surpassed by anything, any system whatsoever. It is the best, it's the leader. أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَنَّا أَنْزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ. Wasn't it sufficient for them that we have descended this book, this perpetual miracle that is suitable for every time and place, for every act of guidance, for every aspect of guidance? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also describes the Qur'an that it is a ruh. Ruh, it's a spirit. Without which, you know, our spirit begins to suffocate, our chest begins to tighten. So this is the key to ridding ourselves from the diseases of the heart. Add to that, of course, following the walking Qur'an. The walking Qur'an is the Prophet ﷺ, is the character of the Prophet ﷺ. As Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was asked about the character of the Prophet ﷺ, she said, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us the best of the best. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us success in following the sunnah and the understanding and the guidance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the straight path and to increase us in guidance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to live so long that we live as Muslims and to die in a state of iman. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُهُ سُبْحَانَكَ وَبِحَمْدِكَ نَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ نَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَنَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّكَ رَبِّ الْعِزَّةِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ وَسَلَامٌ عَلَى الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. جَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.